What is up, guys? Welcome to our last In Conversation With. My name is Sean Moreno. I'm the online pastor at Every Nation Faith City. And man, this has been so much fun. I want to wish you guys a merry festive season. I know it's past Christmas already, but thank you guys so much for watching this. This will be our last broadcast on this page for 2020. Man, what a year it has been. So I want to ask you guys for the last time this year, please follow us on all our social media platforms. I'm talking Facebook, Instagram, WhatsApp, any of the others. Please follow us. They'll be down below as well. And then I want to say thank you guys for your generosity this year. In 2020, it has been a year that we couldn't predict in any way, shape, or form. Because of your generosity, we've been able to do what God has called us to do. To reach people, build lives, and bring supernatural transformation to our world one person at a time. So thank you so much for it. Thank you so much for helping us plant an online church. Whether you know it or not, this is because of your generosity. If you want to give right now, the giving info is at the bottom of the screen. You can go to our website, enfc.co.za/give, and give right now through various platforms. Now, for our last conversation, this has probably been one of the most requested people that we've had ever. I want to welcome our very special guest, Perseverance Mkonto, otherwise known as Percy. Now, let me just brag on her for a second. Percy does just everything. Everything from being a recording artist, to SAR winner, to Paquita Lenfia spokesperson, to just, you name it, she's done it, most likely. She is one of our intern pastors, training to become one of our campus pastors as well. And just such a heart for serving. I've known Percy ever since she's been first year here, and she's grown from being a backup vocalist to the place where she is right now. So Percy, welcome to In Conversation With. It's such an honor to have you.
What do you do? I'm so excited. Finally, yes, I get the last shot. Yes. I'm so excited to be here. I'm super, super looking forward to today's session. So it's going to be incredible.
Awesome. Percy, now I've given you a slight introduction. Won't you tell the people who you are, what you're currently doing at Every Nation Faith City, and just a little bit about yourself?
So as you've heard, my name is actually Perseverance. It's a real name. You can also find it in James. Yes, I featured in the Bible, just joking. I'm basically interning at Every Nation Faith City, part of online church. I'm also doing full-time ministry, which is absolutely incredible, and I'm enjoying every minute of it. It has its challenges, and 2020 was certainly like the highlight of your year. I mean, imagine having your first year in ministry being locked down majority of the time and having to work and grow and navigate around that. So that's really been an incredible journey that I'm looking forward to share. So yeah, that's pretty much what I'm up to and what I'm about.
Awesome. Now, Percy, before we jump into the serious questions, let me ask you this. What is one highlight, one fun memory that you've had from this year, and maybe a lockdown hobby that you've picked up along the way?
So it's definitely driving my roommate crazy. Living with a worshiper is one thing. It never stops. That's the thing. So it's not just the Sunday service. It's 7 days a week. So that was pretty much the Amen. Hobby that I picked up during lockdown. But on a serious note, it was really taking the time to research things that are applicable in our context, figuring things out and strategically, how do we do ministry now without actually being hands and feet on the street? How do we get to do that and have it sustainable? Mm-hmm. So that was really quite an interesting time frame when I had to research all of those things for me personally, because it's things I wanted to figure out. How do I do discipleship online? So that was probably the highlight of my lockdown, and having those conversations post lockdown with people, like, what did you do during your time? How did you grow? What were you intentional about researching or growing in or developing even in skills? So that was pretty much it.
Oh wow, that's such a deep answer. Now Percy, let's jump into the first question. What is your against all odds story? What is the story that you've sort of seen as a life story for you? What is that story for you?
So there used to be this TV show in ETV called I Shouldn't Be Alive. And that would probably be the one thing that sums up my story. So when I was 8 years old, there was a situation where I found myself poisoned with... I was poisoned. So what had happened was I ended up in hospital. And while the doctors were trying to find a vein to inject to get the drip going, they couldn't find one. And I remember the conversation happening outside of the hospital room where the doctors were basically pretty much telling my parents, you brought the child too late. There's nothing that we can do for them. And having that persistence for them saying, there's something that you can do. Just try again. Just try again. And in that room full of doctors and nurses, there was this prayer that was that my mom kept on praying, like, Lord, please come through. Lord, come through. You are a healer of all things. You can heal this child at this moment. And I live to tell the story, but the beautiful part that that really resonates with me is in Luke 4, verse 38 to 40, where Jesus healed Peter's mother-in-law. She was in her bed with high fever, and everyone expected Jesus to do something to help her. And he stood close to her and ordered the sickness to go away. And it's so beautiful for me every single time having to read about a story where Jesus healed the blind, Jesus healed the leper, Jesus healed even the man whose friend's faith was what carried him to the feet of Jesus. And having that be part of my story where Christ came in and healed me in that moment, that stands out for me as becoming my against all odds story that I shouldn't be here. But because of God, because of that healing moment, I am here. And just to tie it in even more special, when Peter's mother-in-law got healed, she got up and served. And it's such a testimony looking back now, seeing that God, metaphorically, I might have not gotten up at the age of 8 to serve in ministry, but years later, how that time frame has shifted into this season, how I'm getting up to serve God now, is really, that it's a big testimony in my life that speaks of God's goodness.
And so one thing that I can just like sort of attest to is the fact that you've served everywhere. You've at least served in every single department of church, whether it be sharing a word, leading worship, doing kids, everything. And so what has sort of been the inspiration behind you serving? What has been the thing that, because obviously you studied law, you studied LLB, which is a very difficult subject, and you didn't quit serving. I remember there were seasons where we were having 5 services on a Sunday and just planted Funabel, and you were still leading worship, driving back, and writing exams the next day. Yeah. Like, what inspired you to serve so committedly?
It's the heart of gratitude. I think looking back to what God has done for me and how can I express that thanksgiving to God would be basically in that, in every area, in every gifting that I'd have, every opportunity that I'd get, it will always come to mind that, God, how can I serve you best in this moment? How can I reflect you as best as I possibly can? Because had it not been for that incident, had I not seen that different side of you, God, had you not touched my life the way that you did, I'd probably be completely different from now. But because of that intervention, because of God reaching into my life and transforming at that age and realizing of who he is, that pretty much became the drive behind every single thing I even got to do. I remember one story when we had to go lead a service at the military, and I was writing an exam at 9 a.m. I was like, Lord, help, because what are we going to do? Is it the service? Is it the exam? Which one is it going to be? And I remember Pastor Henry just saying, like, would this honor Christ? And it wasn't even kind of like a subtle, let me second guess what I'm going to choose right now. It was, God, I choose you first. How are you going to get me through this? Yeah, it's up to you. But everything I honor to you, every single opportunity that I've gotten thus far, even continuing into the future, has been because of that obedience, has been because of that faithfulness. And if that's something I can encourage somebody with, is exactly that. Be faithful with whatever God has entrusted into you, because we are accountable for everything that we have. But the beautiful thing about it is having Christ at the center of every single thing. And that's become the biggest motivation of everything, was gratitude and thanksgiving unto God.
Oh, wow. So you sort of touched on this now. But if you were to sort of give, what is the gift of life that you received through the season of your Against All Odds story? You sort of touched on now with gratitude, but what would be the gift of life that you've seen, whether it's faith, purpose, God's presence? What would be that gift that you discovered?
I think calling was definitely that gift. Realizing that God has created each one of us with something significant. My one pastor used to say, each one of us have something to deposit into this world. And if we withhold that, we basically keeping back what the world should receive from us. And having that as, Lord, what have you called me to? What area can I deposit something significant? What of you can I showcase? And God has always been faithful in every single season in that sense, to always come in and reaffirm that calling, even when it would get tough. Like, yeah. You're called to purpose, you're called to reconciliation, you're called to peace, you're called to all these various things that God equips us and empowers us to be able to do exceedingly and abundantly, because that's who He is. Yeah. So that's definitely one of the greatest gifts I personally have received from God, is that reaffirming in every season of calling and who He's mm-hmm. created us to be.
And so, Percy, for you, I asked Jurgens this last time as well. You were basically on track to have a quote-unquote successful career in what the world defines as success. You were getting passed with distinctions and stuff, and you were completing honors, and you were basically there for all intents and purposes. And almost at the last second, in the world's eyes, you decided to throw that all away and follow God. Mm-hmm. What inspired you to do this? Because it isn't rationality in the world sense, but what godly rationality inspired you to do this?
Yeah, I think sometimes looking at a story like that from a withdrawn perspective, it's easy to say, but you threw everything away instead of, but you gave it to God, you surrendered it back to God, and in time He'll say, pick that up if you need to. For me, it wasn't a difficult decision to make, because deep down inside, I've always known that God, wherever you're gonna take, whatever you're gonna call me to, I'll be faithful to let that go and give that unto you, because you've been faithful till now. So why at the last moment expect you, like, okay, the joke's on you. Let's not. Bye. All of this work was nothing. So it really came in a season of, I'm trusting God with this. It's not the end. It's just the beginning of something more. And I am not defined by my career choice. I'm not defined by the things that I do. I'm defined by God and His calling on my life. And that's the thing that kind of kept me steadfast in that sense. Because, yeah, it is a great career. And by all means, we would flourish absolutely anywhere. I mean, God would plant us there if it was His desire to put us in that area. And we'd be amazing. It would be probably incredible. We'd have the greatest influence in the world. But for me, being called to be an advocate in a different area, in ministry, and having to look at the life of Christ and what that looks like for me was, but God, Jesus, you are also an advocate. Jesus, you're also a lawyer, but in a different sphere. So that gave the comfort of, we do learn these things. We are given the opportunity to equip ourselves and empower ourselves in different skill sets and different knowledge and learning all these things. And God just comes in and breathes in the perspective, the calling over those things of how you're going to use this in ministry. It's going to look like this. It's going to be different, but trust me with it. So that's
so cool, Percy. And I think one thing that I can tell from your story is there's a deep trust for God's voice. There's a deep trust for the Holy Spirit's guidance. Because it isn't, like you said, it isn't a rational thing in from a far perspective. But once you have the godly perspective, it becomes the most logical choice.
Yeah.
It becomes the most obvious thing. And also something that I picked up is you're using the skills that you learned in the ministry. You're not throwing that away, and we can see God's purpose almost coming through that as well. What would be your inspiration for people maybe studying right now, and they're like, man, I don't know if this thing is what I'm doing right now, if I'm ever gonna use it. What is that inspirational thought that you maybe have on that?
I think it's understanding that there's no disconnect between the two. I think often we put the pressure on ourselves to think, but it has to be one or the other.
Yeah.
But when we get the godly perspective, it's actually one of the other.
Yeah.
Because you're equipped in knowing how to do accounting, for example, there are places where you might have to count numbers, do census. I mean, it's in the Bible. Nothing in this planet is new. That's the great thing. So it's not like you'll struggle in doing what you're doing, whether it's in the corporate or it's in the vocation. But it's firstly understanding that the two are not separate. But it's, God, how do you want to use this to glorify you? How do you want to use me attaining these specific skills? Because that's not all that's to us. We're all not built to be one-dimensional. You can only sing and that's about that. That's all that you amount to. But God has broadened out that perspective. He's made us able to do so much more. And because of that, everything works together for good. And that's a beautiful thing. We don't have to work all things together for good. We don't even know where to start. And that's why it's in God's hands. He knows how to work all those things together. I mean, we look at the life of Joseph, how having a dream at one stage in one season and how that came into fruition in a different season. The constant thing that remained was his consistency with God. And because of his faithfulness and not ever shunning that down, he got to where he was because of God because of that obedience to God's call in his life. And that's a beautiful thing. Sometimes you never know who's speaking about you in a room. You don't always have to work to get into a specific area, because God is already having something behind the scenes concerning you. He's already planned out your entire life. It's about you having and taking the step of obedience to trust him with the next step. Even when we are unsure, he is sure, he's certain. And that's a comfort. That's a comforting thing.
Percy, one thing that I've loved to see you grow in and develop is that gifting specifically. And also, as you mentioned with Joseph, I think there's another thing that Joseph did is he bridged the gap between the Egyptian culture and the Israelites. And he was promoted to being second in command over the Egyptian armies, over the Egyptian kingdom, and being almost like a right-hand man to Pharaoh, from place of slavery to being a right-hand man. And a lot of what you've helped us with as an online team and as a church is being a bridge builder, is being a person that not only thinks about our own culture and our own context and own things growing up, but really taking that step of empathy and trusting God to say, okay, let me put myself in other people's shoes. And what would be the one thing over this festive season, obviously lockdown and things, we have been tested with close proximity with people. What has been your, if you can sort of give a key to how do we be like Joseph in that? How do we build that bridge? What has been something God has given you as a tool or as a key in this season?
Yeah, the simplest key is the basic fundamental is intimacy with God. God gives us the grace to be graceful with others. God gives us the patience to be patient with others. And it's exactly that. To not rely on my own strength to navigate relationships, but to see how God does it, and then from there an overflow. So it's easy to become agitated with people at close proximity, because sometimes they might do something that triggers something in you that's always been there, but because now there's a face and a person behind it, they usually are the first ones to receive. There's a villain now to blame. Whereas sometimes we discover that whatever is triggered is not necessarily because of them. It's because of something we've never dealt with before. And it's really trusting God to reveal those certain things and to journey intentionally with people. So before we can even get to that stage and wanting to jump in the water and start swimming, to first start with God. God, help me navigate. How do I steward this relationship? Because I love the person. I care for the person. Yeah. How can I love them well, even in the midst of we're offended with each other right now? How can I honor them the way that you are patient with me in this time, exactly in that way, so that we can build relationship and be stronger together? I mean, even in families, it's one of those things where every family will know what triggers you, but not to keep away and stay away, but to rather be intentional with, okay, Lord, how do I love this person better? Yeah. Do I sit down and listen to understand where they're at, so that we can build and try to find some middle ground so we can work together?
No, that's so good. Now, Percy, we've said a lot, but if you had to sort of find the golden thread through it all, a life message, if you will, what would be your life message through this? What would be if you had to give a school assembly in like 2 minutes, what would be like that one life message that you have for people?
We are called to the ministry of reconciliation. And it starts with reconciling with God and then reconciling with one another. It's also one of the first two commandments that we get in the beginning, is that fellowship relationship that we get with God, we can have with men. If only we sit long enough to hear the voice of God, sit long enough to hear how to steward each other well. And that's pretty much where we grow together. And as Christ is being the shepherd and how he leads us and he shows us how to love, how to care, how to nurture, that's how we should be with one another. Paul says it so beautifully that, owe one another nothing more, nothing less than love. Yeah. And before we can love, we need to learn what love is. And God teaches us that so beautifully, even in Galatians, when you can read that as well. So it basically sums it up in just that. Because from there, from a fruitful relationship with God, we can be fruitful with one another.
That's so good, Percy. Now, just as a final thought, if you had to pray for a specific person, maybe there's someone that God has pressed on your heart, maybe a specific group of people, who would that be? What would be that last final thought that you feel God placed on your heart for today?
I would definitely to pray for people that feel far away from God. If you feel that there's like a gap or a divide between hearing the voice of God or even being in that space or even trying to be vulnerable with God. Because sometimes it can be a scary place, but it's something that I really want to encourage not to fear. Vulnerability with God is the safest place. There's nowhere else in this world that you can find that. So I'd really love to pray for people that want to hear the voice of God, want to come into that place of intimacy with being so close to God that scripture becomes real. It's one thing to read the word, but it's another thing when scripture becomes so real and evident in how you live your life, and even the way that you think has become new, and that's only through a willingness to listen.
Percy, that is so good. Won't you pray for us right
absolutely.
Now?
Yeah, absolutely. So thank you, Lord, that you are good, nothing but good. Thank you that you work all things together for good. You say in your word that you are faithful to your promises, and you for sure keep them. When you send out your word, it accomplishes everything that is sent forth to do. And we thank you, Lord, for each one that feels like there's a barrier, that feels like, Lord, there's a divide, that Christ on the cross, the veil was torn to bridge that gap. So we thank you, Lord, that they can experience you, that the ears may be open to hear your voice, that the sight may be restored to see visions, to dream dreams, to see you in a different light. So we thank you, Lord, that you are even faithful for those that seek you, that those who ask for more of you, that you will show through wisdom and in knowledge, and even through the word, that it may become real, alive and active in their hearts, that your word may resonate in them. So we thank you, Lord, for your goodness, and we trust, Father God, in every single promise that you will complete and that it will come to fruition, because that is a testimony of who you are. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Guys, thank you so much for joining us for our last, not only in conversation, but also our last video for 2020. Man, this has been an up and down year. But I want to encourage you, over this last part of the holiday season, go and watch some of our older videos. Maybe even tag us in some of the videos that you've enjoyed over this past year. 2020 has been such an up and down, but thank you so much for equipping us and watching our videos and participating in the comments. It has been such an amazing year, despite everything else, to launch an online ministry. So we want to thank you for that. If you like today's message, maybe just share it. Maybe tag a friend in the comments. Maybe there's someone that needs to hear this conversation. And also, in this season, while you might be away, why don't you send us a message? We'd love to pray with you. We'd love to connect with you. Even though we're not close together, we can still connect with each other online. And we'd love to pray with you. Maybe this was the first time that you've heard about people that love Jesus or people that are connected to God, and you'd like to establish a relationship with God. Why don't you send us a message right now, leave us a comment, and we'd love to pray with you. This is the first big step for the rest of your life. Man, I'm so, so thankful for this conversation, Percy. Thank you so much. And I'm so excited for what the future holds, what God is still going to do. Guys, be blessed. We'll see you next year. Thank you so much for joining us.